From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to the JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm Dr. Preeti Malani, JAMA Deputy Editor. Today we're discussing an article titled Syphilis, a Review by Dr. Chevalier and colleagues, which was published on October 16th, 2025 in JAMA. I'm joined today by the primary author of this review, Dr. Franco Chevalier, who is an infectious disease physician and deputy medical director at the San Francisco City Clinic. Syphilis is an infection caused by the spirochete called treponema pallidum. Syphilis is transmitted by a contact with infectious lesions during vaginal, anal, or oral sex, or via the placenta during pregnancy, in the case of congenital infection. Worldwide, an estimated 8 million adults aged 18 to 49 acquired syphilis in 2022. In recent years, U.S. syphilis cases have increased substantially, with notable increases among women, along with cases of congenital syphilis. Franco, thank you for joining me today, and thank you for writing an outstanding review article on an increasingly important topic, not just for infectious disease specialists.
Oh, thank you so much for having us today. Yeah.
So there's an old adage attributed to Sir William Osler that if you know syphilis, you know medicine. And I would have to agree. I've personally been humbled many times by an unusual presentation of syphilis. So to start our discussion, I want to ask you a two-part question. First, can you talk about the epidemiology of syphilis in the U.S.? And second, please briefly review the major clinical manifestations. And these questions sort of go hand in hand.
First and foremost, in the U.S., syphilis diagnosis have reached a historic low, actually, in 2000, with only less than 10,000 cases of primary and secondary syphilis reported during that time. However, now over the last 26 years, the annual rate of syphilis diagnosis in the U.S. has steadily increased. And for instance, in 2023, there were over 53,000 primary and secondary syphilis cases that were reported in the U.S., and a total of over 200,000 cases overall, including late syphilis as well. During that time period as well, we've seen over nearly 4,000 cases of congenital syphilis. I think it's worth noting also that between 2019 and 2023, these rates have increased among both men and women, among all age groups and all regions of the United States. So it really affects everybody everywhere. And due to these increases in both primary and secondary syphilis among women, congenital syphilis cases have increased over 106% in the U.S. from 2019 all the way to 2023. And now when we're talking about some of the major manifestations, those can vary depending obviously on the distinct stages of syphilis. So for example, when we're talking about primary syphilis, that's generally characterized by a development of a painless chancre at the site of inoculation. And secondary syphilis generally manifests with systemic symptoms, which can include things like a diffuse maculopapular rash, microcutaneous lesions, and generalized lymphadenopathy as well. And this can be then followed by a latent phase, during which individuals with the infection are serologically detectable, but clinically can be asymptomatic. And then, after years to decades, people can then go on to develop tertiary syphilis. This can then involve severe end organ damage. Some of those things that you may associate this with will be neurosyphilis, cardiovascular syphilis, as well as Commodus disease. However, the other thing worth noting is that if untreated, syphilis can lead to significant morbidity and oftentimes things like blindness, deafness, cognitive impairment, and peripheral neuropathy as well.
So let's move on to diagnosis. And I want to start by saying, I think it's very important for people to be thinking about syphilis. And so for Absolutely. Everyone to have it on their differential. But that said, the diagnosis can be confusing since there are multiple kinds of tests. And the availability of tests can vary depending on the clinical setting. The names might be different depending on where you're practicing clinical care. What is the general approach to serologic testing and diagnosis more broadly?
I concur with you that it can definitely be confusing for many. I think one of the challenges in the diagnosis of syphilis is that we are unable to culture the organism in the laboratory. And so given that we can't do that, we're unfortunately just confined to using indirect methods of diagnosis, mostly the ones that you alluded, which are serologic testing. And so the diagnosis relies primarily on serologic testing in conjunction with clinical evaluation. So looking for those signs and symptoms that I've briefly mentioned as well. And the diagnostic algorithms vary depending on who you ask. There is the traditional approach, which generally begins with a non-treponemal test, which many people perhaps associate or know as RPR or BDRL, which is then followed by the treponemal test, which usually is a TPPA, and that's usually done for confirmation. Whereas the other algorithm is known as the reverse sequence, which generally starts with a treponemal test. And this is typically a newer automated syphilis immunoassay that's called an EIA. And then that's followed by a non-treponemal test for disease activity assessment. And now the interpretation of these serologic results requires the correlation with clinical findings, good sexual history, as well as a prior history of the syphilis test results from the patients, as well as any prior history of syphilis and or treatment that we may acquire from the patients. I mean, all these factors are needed so that a clinician can truly determine whether the patient has a new syphilis infection, and if so, what stage of syphilis are we talking about? And rarely, you may have a high antibody titer that can definitely produce a false negative non-treponemal test result, and this is what many call the prozone phenomenon. Now, this happens rarely. However, when it happens, and if there is a high clinical suspicion for, say, secondary syphilis, and you find yourself to have a non-reactive non-treponemal test, then clinicians should definitely order a repeat testing with serodilution in order to make sure that they can adequately diagnose syphilis.
This is really helpful, and I want to emphasize the point you made, which is to have the prior test results. This can be confusing sometimes to sort out whether it's treated or it's new, and of course, people can get reinfected. So it is definitely helpful to have those prior tests. So beyond serologic testing, when would a lumbar puncture be indicated or helpful?
First and foremost, neurologic complications, it's worth pointing out that they can occur at any stage of syphilis. And during in the first year after infection, neurosyphilis can present. Some of the ones that are most commonly known include a cranial nerve dysfunction, especially cranial nerves 2, 6, 7, and 8. Other findings that you may find are things like acute meningitis and uveitis, as well as optic neuritis, hearing loss, or tinnitus. And some late manifestations of neurosyphilis can include stroke, general paresis, or tabes dorsalis. And those can definitely present way later down the disease course, which is 15 to 25 years after the infection. Thankfully and reassuringly, those are rare, given the antibiotic era that we're in now. But to answer your question regarding the lumbar puncture, generally that's indicated. When a patient with syphilis has any of these neurologic signs or symptoms that I've mentioned, generally speaking, an abnormal CSF, specifically a lymphocytic pleocytosis, or an elevated CSF protein and a positive CSF BDRL can help us to confirm the diagnosis of neurosyphilis. Now, oftentimes the CSF can be normal in ocular and otic syphilis. So in the case of an isolated ocular or otic findings, a clinician can treat empirically for neurosyphilis without obtaining an LP. Neurologic signs or symptoms such as the one that's described can be there, but like I mentioned, can also be absent too. Now, another setting in which an LP may be helpful is also when non-treponemal titers fail to decrease by a fourfold within the expected time frame. For instance, within less than or equal to 12 months for primary and secondary syphilis, or less than or equal to 24 months for latent syphilis or in people that are living with HIV. And if the RPR is greater than or equal to 1 to 32, a clinician may consider an LP as well for CSF examination, if not already completed, to also evaluate for asymptomatic neurosyphilis, which can also be present.
So Franco, there's been some focus on point of care testing for syphilis, and you mentioned this in the review. What is the current status of these tests in the United States?
So there are currently three points of care syphilis tests that are approved by the FDA, one of which is available without a prescription and is FDA approved for home use using a finger stick blood. Now, point of care tests make it easier truly to identify patients with syphilis in settings where phlebotomy may not be available or may be difficult to obtain. For example, think about street medicine programs, jails, or shelters. Point of care tests have a really high sensitivity and specificity and will report the presence or the absence of treponemal antibodies. Now, if the point of care treponemal test is positive, it is still necessary to perform phlebotomy and to obtain a non-treponemal test to confirm the diagnosis and determine the baseline non-treponemal titers. Therefore, the main challenge of a point of care syphilis test is unfortunately the inability to distinguish between current infection and a past treated infection. However, these tests have significant potential to improve access to care and will be most effective in non-clinical settings without readily available access to clinical services, I would say.
Yeah, all of this gets at really Osler's comment that if you know syphilis, you know medicine, and it is extremely complicated. So I want to move on to treatment. You know, I'm just thinking of all the challenges we see, whether it's not enough drug, not being able to give the drug of choice because of allergy. So talk us through treatment based on stage and patient factors and underlying medical conditions. You mentioned HIV. What is the general approach to treatment?
It's worth noting that penicillin is the treatment of choice for syphilis for all stages. So for instance, in early syphilis, I mean primary, secondary, as well as early latent, generally those are treated with a single intramuscular dose of benthicin penicillin G, usually 2.4 million units. For late latent syphilis, as well as tertiary syphilis, without neurologic involvement, those require 3 weekly doses of benthicin penicillin G, 2.4 million units each. Now, when we're talking about neurosyphilis, whether that's ocular as well, and otic syphilis, that will require intravenous aqueous crystalline penicillin G, and that's administered at 18 to 24 million units daily. And it's divided into doses every 4 hours or given as a continuous infusion for 10 to 14 days. Now, in some special settings, for instance, in pregnancy, penicillin is the only recommended treatment in order to prevent congenital transmission. There are alternatives for individuals that are not pregnant. However, alternatives have not demonstrated sufficient safety or efficacy in populations of individuals that are pregnant. When we're talking about allergies or people that may present with an allergy for penicillin, a true IgE-mediated penicillin allergy is very rare. And I think most patients can safely receive penicillin after appropriate assessment, but this may include testing and oral challenge in select cases. And as I mentioned, for non-pregnant patients without neurologic involvement, and also for individuals that have a documented penicillin allergy, there are some alternatives, and that includes doxycycline, which can be given for 14 to 28 days, depending on the stage, as well as ceftriaxone, which typically will be administered as 1 gram daily, intramuscularly or intravenously for 10 days in primary and secondary syphilis. Now, treatment response is generally monitored by serial non-treponemal titers. So you're looking for a fourfold decline in the titers, and this generally will indicate adequate response within less than or equal to 12 months for primary and secondary syphilis, or less than or equal to 24 months for latent syphilis or in people that are living with HIV. And if the non-treponemal titer has not declined fourfold by the timeline that I just described, then you may want to consider additional workup to assess for either a repeat infection, neurosyphilis, or treatment failure, which is really, really rare. And now for some patients, they may have actually a fourfold decline in titers after treatment, but they still may have a persistent reactive non-treponemal test. And this is what we call serofast state. These patients do not necessarily require retreatment unless there is clinical evidence of active infection, basically.
Let's end our conversation by focusing on prevention. In recent years, doxycycline post-exposure prophylaxis has been shown to be effective in preventing syphilis, or at least decreasing the rate of acquisition. And in fact, some of your colleagues have shared their early experience using this prevention tool in San Francisco. What should clinicians know about prevention?
So effective prevention of syphilis hinges on comprehensive screening, as well as like prompt treatment and risk reduction counseling. Now, DoxyPrep, as you mentioned, is a new biomedical prevention strategy where individuals take 200 milligrams of doxycycline within 72 hours following sex activity. And DoxyPrep has been found to be highly effective at reducing the risk of syphilis in men who have sex with men, as well as trans women. And this is indeed an exciting development for us in sexual health, and it's leading to decreases in syphilis incidence in some communities, such as San Francisco, as you alluded, which has been reported in some studies. And the CDC actually recommends that clinicians should counsel patients at elevated risk, particularly those that identify as men who have sex with men and transgender women with a recent STI history, about the potential benefits and the risks of DoxyPrep as part of a comprehensive prevention strategy. Lastly, I would say that in terms of prevention, screening is also a very important prevention strategy, and regular screening is recommended for populations at increased risk, and those may include men who have sex with men, people that are living with HIV, as well as individuals with social determinants that increase vulnerability, such as history of incarceration or transactional sex. And in 2023, the CDC actually expanded syphilis screening guidelines such that all sexually active people between the ages of 15 and 44 years should be offered syphilis screening at least once. And then in 2024, the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists recommended screening for all pregnant people at the first prenatal visit, during their third trimester, and again at delivery. Last but not least, I will say partner notification and treatment of sexual contacts are also essential to really interrupt the transmission chains of syphilis.
Is there anything else that you wanted to add?
I would say that this is a pretty comprehensive storyline of syphilis. And like, as you mentioned, you know, if you know syphilis, you really know medicine, because syphilis is really known as a great mimicker and can do many, many things.
I'm Dr. Preeti Malani, and I've been speaking with Dr. Franco Chevalier about syphilis. You can find a link to this review article in the episode's description. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.